Africa after meeting a minister from Ghana and got an invitation to come to help an organization initiate the first HIV hotline in Ghana, in West Africa really, and this was in 1997. So with the initiation of that program began the information that was necessary for the Ghanaian people to start to develop programs and support groups. So one of the ways that I have really engaged is because of my own personal relationship with these health disparities, and HIV being one of them, and substance abuse also being part of that experience. And so it was probably as early as 1983 when I became infected, and as you can see, you know, in 2016 I'm still very alive and well. I've used education as a tool to help other people heal from the experience of both HIV and addiction. Notice I didn't say cured, but what I said was healed. And what I mean when I say that is that you can put yourself in a health position where the disease is HIV and substance abuse have no real effect on your life. So it's basically 32 years later, and I've not had any opportunistic infections. I've used holistic medicines for the first 13 years, and then since then I've been using Western medicines in addition to the holistic medications that I was using prior to using the Western meds, and have found benefit from both. So my idea was to take this message on the road, you know, to let people know that you don't have to die, first of all, alone, and secondly, there's support in the community, even if it's within the HIV community itself, that can help people change their belief systems from focusing only on what Western medicine can do to expanding to the opportunities that are available through holistic treatments and the kinds of modalities, acupuncture being one of them, massage being another, that actually provide energy and a way for the immune system to continue to support the body even with the presence of HIV and other diseases. Because the truth is, that as long as the immune system is functioning properly, it's impossible to get many of the diseases that we are experiencing as health disparities. Cancer being one of them, HIV, maybe not preventing the HIV infection, but preventing the infection from overcoming the individual. So I've done that now for the last, since 98, that would be 18 years. And my mission is changing, you know, at this point to focusing on the disease of addiction. And that is one that is, in my mind, just as critical as the HIV disease. And for the same reasons, you know, the effect that addiction has worldwide, you know, is not only causing new infections related to HIV, but it's also devastating in its own. Because under the influence, many people become infected with HIV. Underneath the disease experience of addiction are the traumas and the issues that cause those traumas being unresolved and using the substances to cope with the life experiences and the stress generated by poverty, health, cancers, diabetes, all of those issues are interrelated, actually, with HIV and AIDS. So Ghana has introduced its own programs for HIV again with the Ghana AIDS Commission. It has become a viable force in the community in providing HIV treatment. It hasn't been necessary to take medications and organize medication drives to get to the Ghanaian people. And that was primarily for mother-to-child prevention with those medications. But our major focus was developing support groups because that's where I learned how to live well, you know, with this diagnosis. I like to say that the diagnosis doesn't have me. What I'm reminding myself of is that I have a diagnosis of HIV, but I'm still Maurice. And being Maurice is still my primary focus in living, you know, living my life to its fullest. And as it relates to the HIV, is that there's enough support now in the community. There were many support groups that were initiated through people that I came into contact with, and many of those people developed organizations of support. The support groups themselves were a vehicle, as they were for me in the United States, to get the information that was necessary to not only survive HIV disease, but thrive in the presence of this disease. So as I continue to watch the development of support in these areas, my mission has changed. And yes, I'm focusing on the addiction community now. On a national level, in many places in the world, there is denial around the effect that addiction is having on community. And what I've learned about that through my own experience in recovery is that there are ways that we can support each other. Using support groups is one of the ways that we support each other, through the fellowships, the 12-step fellowships, and looking for the emotional and psychological support that's necessary to deal with the traumas that have caused the issues that make addiction possible. And so addiction basically comes from the inability to cope with what is happening as the reality, as one perceives it, of life. And so what addiction does is separate us from what is real and isolates to the point where at the end, no one is a part of the connecting force that is life for the person who is actually engaged in active substance uses, wet or dry drugs.
Okay. I think we left off with you talking about the mission that you have embarked on in Ghana. And
I'm looking at going back to Ghana because I already initiated a collaboration of organizations and people, including the government, the schools, the faith-based organizations, to look at developing a national treatment program. But since then, it's been maybe 5 years since I've been back to Ghana, but I have reconnected with that collaboration, and they are ready now to continue to move forward with the ideas that we initially talked about of developing a national treatment program. But since then also, there has been additional information regarding addiction and connection that is really, I think, key to the communities that I visited, you know, as it relates to the HIV experience and finding that addiction was underneath effect that HIV was having in the Ghanaian community, and I would say almost anywhere else in the world. But HIV and addiction are closely related because most people are under the influence when they come into contact with HIV in the first place. So that was the experience that I was having, but it was the support groups that helped me understand and cope with the issues that were traumas in my own life, and it was the 12-step process that helped me to uncover, discover, and discard the things that caused me to react in such a way that substances seem to be the answer to the question. A friend of mine once asked me, you know, if crack was the solution, what was the question? You know, and that is the question that I had to answer for myself. And I posed that question to others, you know, and when we look underneath the answer to that question, we find that there are ways that we can support one another as we support ourselves in the process of healing. So this trip to Ghana is about focusing on these ideas of harm reduction and of treatment for and prevention for substance abuse. And that in a way will reduce the number of new infections as it relates to HIV disease. And so this is a next step in the mission, really, because the HIV portion of it has been pretty much addressed. Certainly there could be more medications and there could be less stigma and fear around using the services that are available. But the reality of that is there's going to be stigma and fear anyway. You know, the only thing we can do is to be a part of the solution and help reduce the amount of fear and stigma as it relates to people living with HIV or substance abuse, which are pretty much the same in the eyes of most Ghanaian people. You know, the families isolate the persons who are affected, and they definitely create an atmosphere that is less than conducive for the person's health and well-being. And so it's really about making choices, understanding first of all that you have choices, and then secondly, opening up to the experience of the choices that are available by engaging in a larger community. The experience, strength, and hope of other people who are healing from the effect of HIV disease and the effect of addiction are tools for recovery. We say the therapeutic value of one addict helping another is without parallel, and that is absolutely the truth. There is a process that we engage that absolutely uncovers the disease and also provides us with an opportunity to apply the principles of recovery to the areas that are most affected. And so when we do that, what we experience is healing. Not necessarily a cure, because the thinking that created the traumas and the thinking that came as a result of it is still present. But what we do is we apply these principles to overcome the effect. And so we render the diseases neutral. And it's only when we actually pick up again, you know, pick up the behaviors that created the condition for HIV and the condition for substance abuse, that we experience new traumas as it relates to the HIV. But we absolutely have the capability and the support that we need to do so. And it is through connection with the source, connection with our community, connection with a power greater than the diseases, greater than the circumstances, greater than the opinion of others, greater than the opinion we may have of ourselves. Because a lot of the stigma and fear is internalized. So it's not until I address the issues within before I am capable of being of service to the greater cause, which is to relieve the burden of disease in our communities and allow the full functioning of a life well lived based on these principles that we learn. Honesty, open-mindedness, and willingness, we say, are the beginning. But that opens the door to compassion, tolerance, patience, acceptance, peace, surrender, forgiveness. It opens us up to the grace of a loving God, a loving power. You know, I always say to people that are in recovery that we are the fortunate ones, because we were the ones that survived the Holocaust. And we survived the Holocaust of slavery. We still have some remnants of the effect of that generationally in our experiences, and that's part of the trauma that we experience as it relates to addiction and what feeds into the HIV disease. So my mission is to educate. I have a degree in education, and I have had the opportunity to teach in the schools locally and internationally through a nonprofit organization called Aid for AIDS Africa. I've had the opportunity to bring many people to those experiences with resources and ideas that could help improve the communities. I've brought medical practitioners and holistic health practitioners as well into communities that absolutely felt hopeless and without a voice. So we have been communicating through radio and TV, through direct contact with the organizations that provide services, and through the teaching hospitals and medical hospitals in West Africa, Zimbabwe, South Africa, in Senegal. So it's a labor of love for me. It is one that is sustaining my life. It is part of the reason why I believe that I'm still alive and thriving in the face of this. I'm 60, I'll be 64 in July, and I'm 63 in 11 months at this point. But the truth is setting me free, and I believe that is possible for the truth to set others free by transforming the way that we think. And so there are things that you can do to prevent the immune system from being compromised and therefore eliminating the possibility of contracting cancer, you know. And so this whole documentary series talks about those things that other people have done and the kinds of clinics that are available that actually address holistically, you know, how to...
Prior to getting it.
Right. And getting it. And once you have it, you know, helping to eradicate it. Many of the people that they interviewed were on death's doorstep, you know, and...